Have you lads seen Danny, any of you? No, I asked you a question! Have you seen Danny? He was in your boat for sure.
Not with us, Miss Allen. You better go ask Captain Barry.
I'll ask him, all right.
To my sister Elizabeth, our mother's locket, which I know she will treasure. And to my brother James, the pick of any sextant in my store, to be suitably engraved. Signed this day of our Lord, September the 12th, 1880. But there is a codicil. Mr. Oneeding added this codicil to take into account the Married Women's Property Act.
Where are we?
Good man.
James.
Nice. Well, picking it over.
The codicil reads, having passed over the property and estate known as Telford Grange to my dear wife Sarah, under the provisions of the Married Women's Property Act of 1882, and having made due financial provision for her future by separate covenant, I now bequeath a department store to my son Samuel, who shall also enjoy my other remaining property as if it were his own. But only providing that the aforementioned department store remains under his management and under the joint name of Robert Oneedian and Son. Should these conditions cease to be observed either now or at some future date, then all properties revert to my wife Sarah for the whole of her natural life. Assigned this day of our Lord, 15th of March, 1883.
Cunning, crafty devil.
Well, I think that is all for the present. If you would care to attend me in my office tomorrow, shall we say? Tomorrow?
Mr. Andrews, that last part
was added only 3 months ago. He was an astute man, fine businessman. You should be proud to bear his name. Good day to you.
Good day, sir.
Mr. Andrews, that was your idea, huh?
I beg your pardon?
The codicil was your idea.
Your brother was worried. He was proud of the department store. He had ideas. Big ideas.
So knowing that he wasn't too keen, you tied him hand and foot, eh?
Good day, Mr. Oneedian.
Well, get your mother a brandy, will you? She'll probably need it. Come on, lad, step lively.
James.
Oh, no, not now. Look to Elizabeth. I think she's taking it a bit hard. Well, Sarah, that's that then, eh? Shut and finished. Worst part's over now.
For you, perhaps.
Oh, lass, it'll do no good mithering over him. He's gone. Oh, come on, lass, he wouldn't want to see you like this. Got to pick up the pieces. Now, you've no money worries. He's left you well provided for. You're secure.
Oh, you don't understand, James. Just one little bone. It's as though I killed him.
Look, it could have happened to anybody. It was an accident.
Oh, lying on the floor there trying to breathe.
Stop it, sir. Now, you're going to have to look to Samuel. He's the one that will need you now.
Samuel. Yes. I never wanted him tied that way.
You'll not need to convince me. But you'll have to look to him. There'll be storm clouds there, eh?
I can't think properly, not now. I woke up this morning and he wasn't there. I know you and he didn't always see eye to eye, but he was a fair man. A good man. And I miss him.
On your way.
Hi, up!
Get up!
Captain Barry!
I couldn't help it. You think I wanted it? I give warning enough. You heard me. He was your friend. You could have looked to him, Mr. Fatalan, so don't blame me.
You let him go down. Him as could swim like an otter. You let him drown.
You hold your noise, mister. You're in it with me, Fatalan. You're a mate. You knew what was going to be. What were you paid for?
You can have the money. I want my friend alive again.
You've lost him.
I've lost a ship.
When you set that charge to the boiler, you should have warned me sooner.
5 guineas more. Let's still your tongue.
Aboard, sir?
Captain Baines, I presume.
I am, sir. Well?
I have some private business with Mr. Onedin. My name is Buxton. Onedin knows me.
You're the representative of the salvage people. Not our line of country.
I'll lay a small wager that he and I are doing business within the hour.
I'd not bet on that, Mr. Buxton. Well, I thought we'd got rid of each other.
Indeed.
All right, Captain Baines, thank you. Well?
Well, Mr. Onedin, I think you'd say you were fairly treated over the matter of the Neptune.
I'd say the insurers did what they had to do.
Come now. You were happy enough.
Well, what do they want?
They have a problem. They came to me, mentioned your name. Onedin, there was a favor done.
Well?
It's the Indian Queen. She went down with a cargo of copper sheets, a lot of it.
It's not my line, Mr. Buxton, sorry.
Not to lift it, just to check it. Now, the man who bought and insured this cargo is known to my principals. That's why they're on it so soon. I assume this is between us two. Well, he's a businessman. His name is Lilly. He had a factory making iron pipes, all sorts. 5 years ago, that was burnt down. He was a rich man. Then he was burgled, lost £15,000 worth of silver, so he said.
Did they pay you?
Of course they did. And now, it's the Indian Queen.
Comes in threes. Trouble.
My principals are not prepared to accept the loss. Not without checking first.
Well, an overinsured cargo in an overinsured ship. It's been done before.
Will you help me?
Well, I'll have to ask some questions. Usual percentage of the cargo. Well, I'll try and keep it as reasonable as possible.
And discreet.
I'll try.
You're a pleasure to do business with. Hmm. Captain's name is Barry.
Aye.
Very old man, I believe. You'll find his name on some of these manifests and bills of lading.
Of course, your principals face quite a high bill if this is square and above board. Oh, and I will need to hire a diver.
Well, I didn't expect you to swim down yourself. No. There is one other thing. This man, Lily, is a client of a Liverpool banker, name of Beaumont. He might be of use to you.
I'm sure that Samuel thinks that I made Robert put that final clause in the will. But Robert did it for his own good. Robert always knew best, you see.
Letty, Mrs. McGarhy is here, and she says she must speak with you. The doctor asked her to come in, and you sit there. Now you drink your tea and welcome. Oh, Mrs. McGarhy, do come in.
I'll not take your time up, Mrs. Not for long, anyway. Excuse me.
Sarah, this is Mrs. McGarhy. She helps me with the sack mending. In fact, she's my right arm.
And likely it'll get cut off the way things are going down there. You've not been coming down much. Through being so busy up here, no doubt.
I have been busy, yes.
Well, we've not been down there. There's not enough work for a girl to carry on, and you with 30 women set on and no work to speak of.
The last order, I mean...
10 days back. Done with. Nothing new. And us sitting there with idle hands. Well, I'm telling you, Mrs., we've got to talk in, and we know the situation. We've seen it all before, and never a doubt we'll see it all again. We're sorry for you, but on your way. We've heard it all before. We're not taking charity, we know that. But you've not brought us in the work, and we're not fit to go out begging for it.
Oh, nor should you, Mrs. McGarry.
Aye, that's what I say. Well?
You know, I'll do something, what I can.
Lay some off, Mrs. There's two or three already been stirring the pot down there. Oh. Idle hands, and that means trouble. And if you don't bring us in the work, then we shall be at each other's throats and yours too, like as not.
Are you threatening me, Mrs. McGarry?
I'm telling you, we're only earning when we're working. Promise work, and a fair rate for each sack sown. And I'm telling you, there's no work.
I'll find something. Tell them I'll find something, and they'll be kept on. You can tell them that, too.
Captain Baines?
Yes, sir.
I want you to get the ship ready to sail. Oh, and we'll need Smethurst.
What for?
Just get him for me. Tell him to bring his diving gear, tell him it's a deep water job, and tell him that the job is paid well. Oh, another thing. I want you to find a Captain Barry for me.
Liverpool man?
Captain of the Indian Queen.
She's down 30 fathoms. That's the gossip about her.
Oh, forget the gossip. Just find her.
Anything else, sir?
No, nothing else.
Right, you heard, Mr. and Eden. Come on, stow ship safely. Make ready for sea.
Lily.
Ah. I've been off at this cargo by a third party. Now, this Mr. Lilly banks with Mr. Beaumont, and I wondered if you'd done any business with him.
He's a respected man in Manchester, I understand.
So you have done business with him?
In a way.
Oh, shipped with him, eh? Can't have been very happy, otherwise why come to us?
No, no, I've not shipped for him.
Well, but you have done business, eh? Well, have you or haven't you?
I've bought into a cargo, that's all.
Oh, indeed.
Now, there's nothing wrong in that, Uncle.
Oh, no, not so long as it's profitable. So, this Mr. Lilly, he's straight, eh?
Aye.
Good. Oh, thank you.
Good day, Uncle.
Oh, by the way, your mother does know. About the cargo.
Why? You leave her alone!
Hey, she's come here with me!
Tilly,
hey.
Quiet! Quiet, the two of you. You'll both be out. Steady on, Captain. There's all afternoon and all night to go yet.
All right, your own, mister. Bring me to the bottle.
He'll be roaring drunk by six and dead drunk by ten, poor old devil.
Don't serve him then.
He needs his medicine. Just lost his ship. Be his last, most likely. The Indian Queen, you know, Captain.
You, mister! You mind your tongue. Talking about a man behind his back. What are you looking at, mister? I'm taking a drink, all right? Man has a right to take a drink. Even a little.
Of course you have, Captain. And I'll buy you another.
I'll take it.
Drink for the Captain. Good day to you.
What did he want?
I don't know. What do you want? A drink?
Hello, Samuel. Sure. Mother looks a little pale. How's she bearing up?
Well enough, sir, thank you.
I'm sorry about your father, my boy.
Yes, sir.
He's a man of quality. It's a great loss.
It's kind of you to say so, sir. Please, do sit down.
Thank you. And he had vision. He considered things, made up his mind, and then concluded the business with speed. I like that in a man.
Yes, sir.
And he was no believer in sentiment, either. Now, you're aware, of course, that he and I had an agreement.
Am I, sir?
Yes, I was to purchase a share in a mill, and he was to take the other share. Now, the store will benefit handsomely from the arrangement.
It would have benefited, sir.
I'm sorry?
Had the papers actually been signed?
Well, I've signed my part.
To purchase the mill, yes, I understand that, but my father did not sign his part.
Yes, but your father...
Yes, but my father's dead, sir. And death changes a number of things. You see, I cannot be held to personal agreements made between my father and yourself.
Well, then you've a lot to learn, Samuel. The agreement was good for both parties. The profit was fair. Well, damn it, I've already purchased the mill.
Then I trust it brings you profit, sir.
You've inherited something more than his department store. He's bequeathed you his direct manor, too.
Yes, I'm not a child, Sir Daniel. We both knew my father.
Yes. Well, then, it seems we've reached an impasse.
I could perhaps help you out of your difficulty.
Could you, Samuel?
Yes. I intend to retail through the postal trade. Advertise goods for sale in leading magazines and newspapers. It works in America. And we now have an excellent postal system for parcels, far better than theirs. You see, in America, huge catalogues go out from these stores in New York and Boston and so on, right across the country. And people buy New York goods as far away as California. Well, I intend to do the same through catalogues such as this.
And you can help me out.
Your mills can provide cotton sheeting. Mm. Now, Mrs. Anedin has women working for her at the moment, 30, I think, at the present time. And she needs work for those women. They'll make up your cotton into sheets and pillowcases and so on, and I'll advertise them with the slogan, direct from the warehouse.
Yes, but does Letty know of this?
No, not yet, but can you supply?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
My prices, of course.
Well, I'm not so sure about that.
Then I'll go elsewhere, sir.
You're a cool customer for one so young. I think you'll find these prices to your satisfaction, my boy. Not asleep yet, Samuel. You see, your printer happens to be a member of my club. Good morning.
James, how nice to see you.
Well, well, well. Oh, I never thought to see the day.
I beg your pardon?
You, sewing. Here, I must tell Letty. It will please her.
You've come on business.
There, you see. I passed by hoping for a nice warm welcome and immediately it's assumed that I'm here on business. You ought to have been a man.
That's not what Daniel says.
Well, I suppose he would know. You happy?
Why not?
No reason.
James, what reason?
Well, if you don't know, then it can't concern you.
Oh, you really can be so maddening sometimes. Mm. Now, what is it?
Nothing. Otherwise, you wouldn't be sitting there making pretty little things like this. What fine needlework.
James, what are you talking about? Now, stop doing that and tell me. James.
Well, it's always the same with these insurers, isn't it? Takes so long to pay up, don't they?
Well, you would know better than I.
I admit it, mind you. With this insurance claim that you're pressing, you'll find the same.
Yes, I suppose so.
Hmm. Mind you, with a businessman of the reputation of Mr. Lilly's, I shouldn't think there's any reason to worry. Daniel's no fool, is he? Mind you, new face on the horizon does need watching, as Daniel will tell you.
Yes, I suppose so. Hmm.
When I spoke to William about it, he seemed very vague. Still, it's no concern of mine, as long as you're happy.
James, I hope you won't think me rude, but I do have another appointment.
Of course, of course. Well, give my regards to Daniel. I'll see myself out.
I must tell Letty, she will like this. Mr. Dunwoody.
Mr. O'Neill. Lady Elizabeth, I have some papers
not
for
now,
you to sign.
Not now, Dunwoody. What of my son and Mr. Lilly? Tell me all you know.
Oh, dear, I only confirmed this morning. Master William bought into part of the cargo of a ship. Oh, sheet metal it was. It went down. Well, you may recall the Indian Queen went down two or three nights back. A ship and cargo lost.
Bought? With what?
Well, you did agree he should have a certain number of checks for the day-to-day expenses of the office, I suppose. Indeed, I now know he used one of them.
Without your knowledge?
At the time, yes, madam.
You've landed that lad in trouble, sir.
He's too big for his boots by half, that lad. Still, I expect Sister Elizabeth will cut him down to size, eh? Now, did you find Smethurst?
He's on board, sir.
Ah. And Barry?
Oh, he hardly moves, sir. He's drinking himself stupid.
Hello there, Jacko. Fit, are you?
I'm fit enough, yeah. Captain Baines here doesn't seem overjoyed to have me aboard.
If you was meant to swim beneath the sea, the good Lord would have given you gills.
Now, have you got everything you need?
Yes. Some say it's the Indian Queen we're to be looking for. Is that right?
You said a quick return, Josiah.
Well, so it would have been if the cargo hadn't gone to the bottom of the sea. Don't worry. Once the insurers pay, you'll see your capital back.
Which will take time. You said as much. Look, I can't possibly afford to pay it from my own pocket.
Why should you?
I wasn't supposed to use a company check for such a purpose.
Well, then, my friend, there is little you can do but admit that you were in error. I'm sorry, William, but you must learn to walk before you can run. Now, as you were saying, Anedon was questioning you about Mr. Lilly.
Yes, my uncle's been asked to carry a cargo for him, that's all.
The devil he has. Mr. Lilly said nothing of it to me.
But perhaps he felt it wouldn't interest you.
But why is he asking Anedon to carry for him? Why not you? After all, it would be small recompense for your loss. That is to say, your temporary loss.
Yes. Yes, it does seem strange.
Find out, William. Use your family connections. Someone will know.
My uncle plays a close game.
I want to know. If you find anything, I'll be at the club tonight. You best come along and see me there. I'm dining with Mr. Lilly, and I want to know where I stand. Find out.
You are, Captain?
Aye. I'm an old man, Captain. Well, you have a life ahead of you. Do you love your ships, Captain?
Yes, I do.
Once round the Orn, there was a man washed over. You know the run there. Catch the weather right, you're through like so. Get it wrong, and you're done for. That man washed over was my brother. Now I'm washed ashore, on a beach, finished.
Perhaps.
No one has talked to me since I lost. 3 days back, she went down under me. Boiler blew and she went down under me, Captain Anedon. You ever lost a ship? You?
Yes.
Your boiler blew? Festering business now! All business! Profit! And be damned to them as gets it for them. Be damned to the ships they send down.
Send down, Captain?
Don't think of they don't see what you and I say to him. When he leans to the weather, half acre sail, tight as drums in the wind, water under the bow isn't past. Do they see that? You see it, I do, he does. Not them. They sees crabbed writing in a ledger. Profit, loss.
How far off were you when you went down, Captain?
At a mile, I'd say. Off Cromer's Head, like a stone.
Cromer's Head? North or south?
Due west. I've got no exact bearing up and too fast. She was doing maybe 10 knots when she blew. She was old Indian Queen, but I love that ship.
A mile off Cromer's Head. No more exact than that, eh?
You in salvage, are you?
You let her lie in peace. I hate salvage men, vultures. I thought you was a seaman, not a scavenger.
I'm as much a deep seaman as you are.
Now drink on me own, mister. Only ship I ever lost.
Out. Metal hold ship. Compass not adjusted properly. What do you think?
Well, if she went down here, well, it says it did, it'll not be easy, James.
No.
We've got the highest spring tides. Be a miracle if the ship's there in one piece, you know.
Only one way to find out. It's to go and look. Will you die?
I'll try, yes.
Good.
James.
Huh?
Look. You see this line he was taking. Now, if it had kept on that course, he'd have gone over one shoal after another.
Maybe he didn't intend to bring her back. Well, he can be made away. There he is, without a penny to his name. Somebody offers him a nest egg. Oh, it's a temptation.
Money. You knew that when you were given those signed checks. You knew what they were for. Day-to-day affairs of the office. You knew that and you used it dishonestly. You bought a cargo. No word to me, no word to your father.
Do I run the office or do I not?
Don't you dare take that tone with me.
Elizabeth. What was the cargo, William?
Copper sheet.
For a quick return,
yes.
For your pocket. Well, at least you have the grace not to deny it.
Well, why should I? It was my risk, my judgment.
And company money.
It will be paid back.
Always providing the insurers will pay up.
Well, Mr. Beaumont assures me they will. It might take a little time, that's all.
Mr. Beaumont may have assets to cover his losses. You have nothing.
Have you been to the exchange today, William?
No.
No. Well, this morning there was a whisper that the Indian Queen was being investigated. The Salvage Association had been called in to check. Now, you had James and Eden in your office this morning.
He was here too, Daniel, but he said nothing.
Now, one of his ships sailed this afternoon. It was carrying a diver. Now, what do you think, William?
The ship sank and the cargo was lost. That's all there is to it.
Providing it was all above board, yes. But if that transaction was in any way illegal, they will not pay. And you will have lost a great deal more than the money. The trust of the insurance company, William.
Sir, I assure you it was not illegal.
Well, I hope for your sake you're right. And now, if you'll excuse us, your mother and I have business to discuss.
Haul him up. Don't stop pumping!
Thank you.
Come.
James! There's nothing down there. No debris. There's no sign of any ship. Oh, we're wrong, James. Or rather, Captain Barry is.
Are you sure?
He said the boilers blew and they abandoned ship. That means they went down fast. Now, there'll be signs on the seabed, things scattered about, but there's nothing. Nothing at all. Oh, he's lying.
Oh, damn.
I'll be asking Captain Barry a question or two when we get ashore, and he'll tell me, old man or no.
More wine, Beaumont.
You have to answer my question, Mr. Lilly. Why give a cargo to the Oneida Line?
I haven't answered, my dear Beaumont, for the simple reason that there is no answer.
I don't understand.
There is no cargo for this Oneida. Never was and I never will be.
Why did he suggest there was?
I'm afraid I've no idea. Is he drumming up work? Perhaps heard I was doing some shipping. It's happened. Or fool him.
He's no fool, I can assure you. He's dangerous to cross.
As I am, Mr. Beaumont. Well, you best find out. You have the contacts. Ask Mr. Fraser to be so kind as to join us.
Yes, sir.
Your friend?
He invested in part of that cargo.
Oh, of course. Well, he'll have to wait like the rest of us.
Oh, William. May I introduce you to Mr. Lilly?
How do you do? Do sit down, Mr. Fraser. Join us. Do you have something to eat? A glass of wine?
No, nothing to eat, thank you, sir.
We were discussing your uncle, Oneidin.
He sailed this afternoon carrying a diver. My father was in the exchange this morning. There's doubt about the Indian Queen.
Doubt, sir?
The salvage operatives hired my uncle.
Indeed.
Well, Mr. Lilly.
It'll do you no good to hear more nor to speculate more, Beaumont.
If there's more to tell, then I insist on hearing it, sir.
Some wine, William. I may call you William, may I not? After all, we are partners, so to speak. The ship went down. True. An old ship with an even older captain. He wanted to retire, but he had no money. Now he's able to retire with a few guineas in his pocket.
He scuttled the ship.
The ship went down, Mr. Fraser. Yes. But our cargo did not.
I don't understand.
No, of course you don't. The copper sheets were never aboard her. Yes, I know what the manifest says, but then Captain Barry had to earn his retirement. So he took charge of that little matter. The copper sheets will be sold in due course.
And the insurance?
Oh, there. Well, we will, of course, collect that as well. And the insurance on the ship, of course. It's not uncommon practice, and no one loses except the insurance company.
I'll have none of it. Nothing to do with it.
Should you breathe a word, my young friend, you'll find you're tied to me hook, line, and sinker. I've your name to papers, bills of lading, and a Fraser check. You're in with me. So are you, Beaumont. Up to your necks.
I'm sorry, William.
But come, friends, why the long faces? You'll make money, we all will. So drink up and enjoy the night.
And if Oneidin finds anything?
He'll find nothing. The crew have gone, and now the captain's gone. There's no one to ask. There's nothing to find. Of course, you could talk to your uncle. Persuade him to let sleeping ships lie. Aye, why not talk to him, William? Point out the little difficulty. For be assured, boy, I have you by the throat.
I want to talk about it.
And I don't, anyway. Now's not the time, Letty.
I'm in a hurry.
Oh, you're always in a hurry, and I won't be satisfied with it. Look, James, all I'm saying is that I'm not young, and I want your child before I'm too old to enjoy it. Well, at least let's talk about it.
And I said not now, Lydia, and I meant it. Oh, Luke, we're happy as we are.
In other words, my interests don't concern you. You want everything your way.
Letty.
I thought you said you were in a hurry. Don't let me keep you. I'm sure you've got more important business.
I'm meeting a Mr. Buxton. Tell him I'll meet him on board the ship.
James. Oh, James, I'm sorry if I upset you.
Letty. Give it time, eh? Just... Well, not yet.
Father, there's a man that insists on seeing you.
That'll be Mr. Buxton. Well, show him in, Charlotte.
So, I must see him. Who
the devil are you?
Oh, I'm sorry to barge in on you like this, sir. Oh, ma'am, you'll forgive me. You don't mind, sir?
I do mind. What do you want?
Well, what would you say if I was to tell you I was the first mate on the Indian Queen?
Letty, if you'll excuse us, please. Go on.
And if I was to tell you you're wasting your time by listening to Captain Barry, who's only after telling fairy stories to cover himself, what would you say to that?
I'd say you was wasting your time, because I know that already.
Well, then, sir, let me tell you this, then. I had a mate went down with that ship. Danny. Good mate to me and a cousin. Him with a wife and kids back in Crookhaven. And him dead because that loin captain tells me would be safe and sound.
You mean Captain Batty?
Aye.
Did he scuttle her?
Well, not say a word of that, mister. You're salvaging her. I want Danny off me conscience. I want a word or two said over him to make it right.
Where did she go down?
I took bearings.
You took bearings?
I have a ticket for mate, sir.
Come with me. Let him.
So that's where she lies. Right on the edge of that deep. It's not a good place to dive, James. With these high springs, there'd be a strong current running. Well, best go now while there's still time.
What do you mean?
Well, after high tide tomorrow, so I'll not go down. That current could sweep me into the deep.
Captain Baines, make ready, then.
You won't be needing me along if you just put this over the side when you come to the spot, please.
You'll be staying with us. Thank you very much, Baines.
Uncle James? Uncle James, I have to talk to you.
No time, William, sorry.
It's about the Indian Queen, Uncle.
No, I'm sorry. We're leaving.
Supposing you find out she was Scotland.
If I find that, I'll tell the insurers. They hired me. They get what they paid for.
Uncle James, listen.
No, you listen to me. Now, listen, scuttling a ship is a crime. Not just legality, not just the law, but the crime of the sea. Now, it matters to Captain Baines. It matters to me. It matters to any man on board the ship who calls himself a sailor. Now, if you will excuse me. Baines, are we set?
Sure, this is the right place.
As far as I can tell, when the boiler went off, there was a bit of a panic, to tell the truth.
I'm sure there was.
How long has he stayed down there?
Depends. I don't like it, to tell the truth. He can come out wrung out, a rag. It's a dangerous game. Hey, you there! Keep pumping. He's lice on the end of that line.
father's warned you. He doesn't want you to go on seeing Will.
But he doesn't care what I want. He just thinks about himself.
He's your father.
I wish you'd speak to him, Letty. Well, why shouldn't I see William?
You know as well as I do why not. Your father says you're not to marry him, and there's an end to it.
Oh, Letty, you're no help at all.
Charlotte!
Jekyll?
Well...
Take your time.
No, she's down there right enough, but there's nothing storming that I can see.
Yeah. Are you sure about that?
Well, I've checked what I can, but she's lying at an angle, so I couldn't see all of her.
Now, you said the boiler burst and she went down fast. That means she must be holed.
Mr. Buxton. Go on, Jekyll.
Well, I went down into the aft hold. The seacocks, they're open.
Well, quite clearly, she was scuttled. What have you got to say to that, Fitzalan?
Ask Captain Barry.
I've got to know if those copper sheets are still down there. You must go down again.
No.
Look, I'll pay you.
That ship is lying on the edge of a deep. Now, that's a cleft in the seabed. If she tips, she's going over. The tide turns within the hour. That ship goes over the edge.
But she's not turned yet. Look, you can do it. I'll pay. 5 guineas.
I'm risking my life. That shit goes over the edge. It's a coffin for me, mister. 5 guineas?
I've got to know.
Fitzalan, which hold was that copper sheeting in?
It took me on after the loading.
Oh, come on!
Center hold.
How much would you do it for? Believe me, I know what I'm asking you. How much?
50 guineas. And 100 for the wife if I die in it.
Done. He's only just got down.
Look, he's an experienced diver, and he's risking his neck for you.
He agreed to go down there into the hold. Time is running out. I've got to know.
Right. Well?
James, there's air coming from the forecastle inspection hatch. Bubbles of air. Now I need a weighted line and a crowbar to open there.
Air? If Johnny's anywhere, he's in that forecastle.
He could be there, mister. Oh, Needin, you're wasting valuable time. How could he be there? No one could survive. The air would be foul. If he was there, he'd have been dead days ago. Smethurst, we agreed to come out here to find out if that cargo was aboard.
If it's a big pocket of air, there could be a chance. I mean, that ship that went down in the Clyde recently. There were men alive inside her for days.
I can't serve two masters, James. Captain Baines, how long before that tide turns?
10 minutes, no more.
But I can't do both, James. Now, what's it to be?
Go for the forecastle.
Right, screw up my plate. And James, when I pull on that line, you pull me up fast.
You're making a mistake, Onedin.
Not while there's a chance of saving a man's life. Not. Pump!
You've idle hands in your workshop, Aunt Letty.
I'm expecting a large order, Samuel.
Not my information.
Well, then your information is at fault.
I see.
What is it, anyway?
Pillowcase.
Who made it?
It's a sample. I can take it elsewhere, Letty. I had thought to help you.
You'd thought to find sweatshop prices. Now, my women do good work, fine work.
Shoddy. See? Shoddy workmanship. We'd not make like that. Ours is fine work, mister. None of that rubbish.
Spoil the ship, Samuel, for a heap of the tar?
Take a farthing off the price and you shall have the order. 30 gross.
50 gross and you shall have the farthing.
40? No. Oh. Oh, very well, I'll tell Sir Daniel to have the bales of cotton sheeting.
Tomorrow, he said. I've already talked to him. Thank you, Samuel. Good day, then.
Good day.
We tried.
You know damn well that ship was scuttled, William. Now then, the cargo, was it still on board?
Well, was it, William?
What about your diver, Uncle? Did he say the cargo was still aboard?
He didn't have time. And now the ship's too deep for anybody to dive for it.
James, you've no proof worth a candle. They'll pay up and that's an end of it. You're angry about a ship. All right, I understand that.
Just a ship. A man. A man was in there, too. Trapped in the forecastle.
I don't believe.
Well, then go down to my ship. Have a look at him if you've got the stomach for it. 4 days in the dark. He must have been mad when he died. Just look at his face. Huh?
Is that the truth, James?
Oh, here. Yeah. Have this to remind you. He had it in his hand. Hang it up, William. Hang it up as a memento!